one thing that keeps coming to me from Philippians 2, or Philippians in general, is this statement of all for the glory of God. That Paul, again and again and again, pushes us as believers through Philippians to do all things for God's glory, to do all things so that he would be praised, to do all things with his glory, his kingdom, his power, his majesty in mind. And in Philippians, he's pushing the church to a place of maturation that he often doesn't get into in other epistles, because he's dealing with so many squabbles and so many things. In the Philippian church, they were healthy, so he was pushing them forward to a greater place of maturation, a greater place of seriousness in their faith. And in chapter 2, he kind of transitions from a nice opening chapter, and in chapter 2, he really begins to kind of step on our toes in some areas, in all the right ways. He gets rather vicious, if you will, in attacking and going after our ability to love one another, to serve one another, and what that looks like in light of the cross. And as I've been going through these scriptures this week, I've been challenged, because before we get into this, it's so easy for us as a church to think, okay, I've heard this message like a million times before. I get it. As a Christian, you're supposed to be nice to people and love one another, walk in unity. Let's treat others well, right, as we grow. We know that, Pastor Aaron. Well, obviously, Paul didn't think we knew it enough, because he addresses it in chapter 1 and says, I pray that you love one another. And then in chapter 2, he immediately jumps right back into it and begins to get very specific on the behavior that believers should have in their love and their servanthood one to another and to mankind in general. And as you read through these scriptures, thinking that you know what it is to love, you are instantly aware, or at least I was instantly aware, of all of my inadequacies to love as Christ has loved. Because Paul takes the bar of love and servanthood and raises it up to the cross of Christ and says, this is the standard. And so what I would like for you to do this morning is demolish any type of preconceptions of, yes, I've heard this message before. Let's preach on something deeper today. Let's talk about the move and the power of the Holy Spirit rather than these fundamental things called love. Well, church, Paul says, make my joy complete by loving one another. That there was just this one final thing that they needed to do, and that was to love one another and serve one another. And in that, he said that his joy in them would be complete. And so today, let's strip off everything that we think we know about love. And let's really allow this message of Paul's to penetrate our hearts. And not only that, my prayer is that you would begin to allow this message to infiltrate your relationships right now. On every level, husbands and wives, allow what he says here to begin to infiltrate your relationship this morning. Men, begin to look at what he is saying and ask yourself, do I love my wife in this way? Do I love my children in this way? Begin to think about then your outer circle of family that you have. Begin to think about, I know that in my outer circle of family, that's where the interesting things begin to take place, right? You can pretty much get along with the tight circle, where you're all good with them, but then it's that kind of outer circle, you know, that when you, if you've ever been to a family reunion, you know, it's like the weird uncle that comes out of the closet and nobody really wants to talk to him. Or you have those strange relationships or strained relationships with people that maybe you don't see every day. So it doesn't force you to work through your issues with them. You can kind of put your issues to the side, right? Because you only see them once or twice a year, maybe. And you're so gorging yourself with turkey and dessert that it doesn't matter. You can kind of just gloss over the fact that you really hate that person and they really hate you. Come on now. That there is an outer circle of family and friends that we also must allow this message of love to penetrate within, to demolish our schisms and our divisions between one another, and to bring love into the relationship. And then you begin to allow this message to infiltrate your relationships at work. The thing that I love about this message is because just spending 8 years in business training and management training, everything that Paul is saying here is the exact diagram the world thinks that they have come up with for effective leadership. It's called servant leadership. right? Well, Jesus discovered that over 2,000 years ago and has been teaching us to it ever since, right? So the world is just now catching on to what Jesus had initiated. And so within our relationships at work, if you want to be a leader or a manager at work, or you're in a position of leadership or management at work and you want to lead them well, then you love them as Paul asks you to love one another. That we lead people towards Christ in our love for them. Let's read in Philippians 2, chapter 1 through verses 11. This is what I'm going to get through today. It says this: is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I want to read to you very quickly out of the New King James Version, because there's a few words that they use I like a little bit better. It says, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, any comfort, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. Those are the two that I really like they use. Selfish ambition or conceit. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. And then Paul immediately points us to the cross. It is by no coincidence that the first thing that Paul does in talking to us about love is pointing us to the cross of Christ. Because first and foremost, some of the things that he is addressing here really have to do with one thing, and that's self-idolatry, self-fulfillment, pride, putting yourself in the position of the Creator, wanting things to work out perfectly for your benefit at all times, basically putting yourself up on a pedestal and others down below you. So he brings the cross up and puts it directly in our faces to remind us to whom the glory belongs. That each and every day we live with humility of mind, remembering that there is one that is greater than all of us. Hallelujah. That he is King of kings and Lord of lords, that Jesus himself willingly went to the cross and deserves the worship of our hearts, the adoration of our hearts. And if we confess ourselves to be Christians, our hearts should be outwardly looking at the cross at all times so that we may live in the very shadow of it. Paul blatantly throws the cross in our faith to remind us of someone who is worthy to be worshipped, taking ourselves out of the center of our lives and putting Jesus at the center of our lives. This is kind of a cheesy acronym, but it has stuck with me all week, so it's effective. One commentator says out of this scripture that JOY is an acronym for Jesus, others, and then yourself. That is how you operate in joy. That is where you find the utmost of joy, is putting Jesus at the center of your life, others next, and then yourself last. Because in that you find joy, and you can't spell joy by starting with yourself or with a Y. But yet in our culture today, everything screams at us that it has to be us first. That we remove ourselves from our places of worship is the first thing in conquering this self-worship that we have. He points us to the cross because the cross gives us the motivation to love. He draws us to the cross first because it gives us the motivation, the fuel to love. That's why we say, live the gospel, give the gospel. Jesus is everything. Because as you constantly revisit the truth of the beauty of the gospel, it is the fuel that gives you power to live the Christian life. Amen. You don't live good to get the gospel. You get the gospel and then your life is changed for the good. Because there's a motivation. There's something that reminds you each and every day. It's from within. There's a joy. There's a power that comes that gives you the motivation to begin to love. One can only love as Christ loves when they continuously celebrate the miracle of his love. 1 John 4:7 through 11 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also so should love one another." That the cross itself provides for us a motivation to love others as Christ has loved us. When you celebrate each and every day continuously the fact that you are a sinner saved by grace. And the older you get, the more you realize how true that is. Because you've had some years to look back on your life and go, well, I regret, or I wish I would have done that differently, or what have you. The older you get, the more you realize that only his grace is what keeps me. It's what fuels me. His love for me, that I am accepted unconditionally. And as you grow deeper and deeper in contact with that truth, the more you can give out of that truth. I think every day you should get up and think about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Think about what you've been saved from, how you've been saved. The fact that Hebrews celebrates that you are the righteousness of Christ Jesus on no merit of your own, but only by his saving grace. Amen. So the cross gives us the motivation to love. The cross gives us the supernatural ability to love. See, the world, the people who don't have Christ, don't have the ability to love as Christ has loved. Now, they may operate in good morality, but they will never switch over to the fullness of what it is to love this way. Right? Because they spiritually cannot. They're dead. They have not been awakened unto new life with Christ Jesus. So therefore, they don't have the ability to live that way. But through the cross, you have been given the supernatural ability to love. Yes, but Pastor Aaron, you don't know what a stinker my uncle is. Or you don't know what a stinker my brother-in-law is. Or you don't know what they've done to me. You know what? I don't. Christ does. And in the cross, you've been delivered from an eye for an eye and a tooth for tooth and been brought into his saving grace. Amen. And through that has killed your flesh, which was at enmity with God, and has therefore given you the supernatural anointing, flow of the Holy Spirit to walk in the fruit of the Spirit with those around you. The scripture in Romans 7, chapter 7, verses 5 through 6 says, "For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law." Now, what were the law? Again, it was an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, right? That is what the law said. Well, he says, "which we are aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the letter." I could even say we are now called to walk in the newness of our new life and not in the oldness of our old life, right? So those things of hatred, those feelings of selfishness and conceit that came to us with Jesus, we should be able to begin now to separate ourselves from those things and to be able to freely love one another without any of that false motivation within our hearts. Can I get an amen? The third thing is that the cross gives us an example of how to love. 1 John 3:16 says, "By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren." His cross gives us a full and thorough example of how we are called to love. Let me just say this. We cannot receive the benefits of his sacrifice and then refuse to follow his example. These things should not be, church, that we with our mouths utter the fact that we are saved by grace, but yet we don't give grace to anyone. But yet we don't live our life as Christ lived his life. Now, again, I'm not saying we are perfect, but there should be a progression of maturity that we are moving in our relationships with one another. Right? I'm not writing letters to my wife anymore. Do you like me? Yes, no, maybe. Check one box. All right? Now, that was great in like eighth grade. She'd probably find that kind of cute right now. Look at her. Mental note. All right. So, but you know, if I was still doing that, at like nowadays, trying to get her affection, it would seem very immature and silly. And she would want something a little bit more, I would think, at some point. Right? Well, it's the same way in some of our relationships. We still act like that we're in junior high. Right? Whatever they do to me, I need to do them in worse, or they're going to get what they deserve. Right? Or we're fighting for ourselves, for our popularity. Right? Remember junior high was like all about popularity, who was popular and all that junk. Right? Well, within the cross, it gives us the example of how we are to love and how we should be maturing in that love. Let me give you some expressions of Christ. And I'm going to do a series on this next year around Resurrection Sunday. But there are seven things that Christ uttered as he was dying on the cross. And they give us great insight into his character and into what he was doing there on the cross. And you know, the final words of a dying man are very important. That usually some of the greatest substance come out of the mouths of those who are facing the face of death. And here, Jesus utters, I believe, some of the greatest wisdom. And in the first three things that he says, you can go by it line by line and scripture by scripture, we see this example of love being poured out upon the cross in his final moments of life. And the first thing that he cries out as he is being nailed to the cross, after upon being beaten and bruised, striped and pierced, he cries out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Our servant Savior's first words upon the cross are words of forgiveness. As his guiltless blood falls to the ground, mercy falls from his lips. Again, I encourage you to think of your relationships now and the difficulties you might be having. Is the pressure anything like the cross would be? But yet, Jesus was continuously looking outward in love rather than inward of self-concern. That he cried out to the very ones who were pounding the nails into his hands, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. You might be going through some circumstances in your relationships today where it feels like they are driving the nails of the cross into your very hands. Can you muster up the grace that Christ mustered up for us and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? Another expression that just blows me away as he says to the thief that asked him if he could be welcomed into his kingdom, Jesus looked to him and says, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Even in this place and time of abuse and affliction, Jesus cannot leave a prayer for help unanswered. Even now, as forever through the ages, the feeblest cry of faith compels him to rise up in response. Again, Christ being risen up, and here's one thief on one side saying, well, if you are the Son of God, why don't you save yourself? And in fact, why don't you save us with you? Mocking him, making fun of him. And the other one stands up for Christ and says, have you no respect or fear of God even in your dying day? And he asks Christ out of the pitifulness of his situation because they both deserved to be there. And Jesus could have turned to that thief and said, you know what? You're getting what you deserved. I am holy and blameless upon this cross. But no, he looked to him, and as faith was mustered up inside of that criminal, as he cried out for mercy, Jesus could not resist. And the love of Christ was not limited to being on a cross, but was active while he was on the cross. The last thing, and I've talked to you about this before, that blows my mind is he looks out at Mary, who is weeping at the foot of the cross, seeing her son crucified and brutally beaten and wounded. He looks at her and says, "Woman, behold thy son. Disciple, behold thy mother." When Jesus should have been the foremost concerned about the welfare of himself, he is consumed by the welfare of others. Looking down upon Mary, seeing her heart breaking, he wanted to make sure that she was taken care of and received comfort by that care. And he pointed out unto her the care that would be given to her through one of his disciples, continuously looking out in love. This is the example of how to love, and nothing short of it is unto the glory of God. This is the standard that has been raised up for us to compare ourselves to. How are we doing? Number four, the last thing, the cross. I love this one. The cross continually reminds us of how much more we need to grow in love while providing the grace to cover us when we don't. I remember looking at this scripture and I'm like, are you kidding me? This is the level? This is the comparison? Really? No one could ever achieve that. And at that moment, the power of the cross hit me and said, and when you don't, my grace is there to cover you. So we have this great, I want to say, tension between us, that we are comforted by his cross and his grace, but at the same time, we are challenged to live in a way that brings glory unto his name. And this, if the word of God is true, is the standard. Paul makes no exceptions about it. He goes on to say, as he's encouraging us and looking at the cross, he says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ. Let this mind be in you. What does that mean? It's a mindset that you have to have. It's a transformation that has to take place in your life. The encouragement to have the mindset of Christ in love and servanthood is not only for the benefit of others, but for your benefit. We often think about the love that we give is because it benefits those that we love. The truth of the matter is it benefits you just as much as it benefits them. The scriptures say this, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded, which he is encouraging us to do here, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. You want life and peace in your relationships, then you need to begin to operate in the blueprint of the cross of Christ. To love and serve this way takes a constant renewal of the mind. Romans 12:2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, which could not be more appropriate for what we're talking about right here. Do not be conformed to this world. In other words, don't let this culture of I matter most infiltrate your thinking. Don't be bought into the lie. Don't give over into the fact that you are the most important being on earth and everybody else falls around you. Right? Oh, but Pastor Aaron, I don't live that way. Really? What happens when the guy at work gets a promotion that you deserved? Hey, I'm going to tell myself, I was faced with this when I was in Minnesota. We went to visit a very successful church. Went to go look into the, you know, I wanted to get around and just look at the building. And I'm walking around the building and I'm like, man, I'll just take the youth room. Just give me the youth room. We can have church in there, right? I just need something that size, Lord. Why are you, like, blessing these people enormously? And here I am just going at it, you know, believing God for a building. What's happening? Some jealousy began to rise up in my heart. Some hard-heartedness for a minute began to infiltrate my spirit. And I was struggling with this thing eternally, you know, trying to put on the nice face on the outside, but on the inside, I'm like, these little suckers. I want a building this big. I mean, it just began to infiltrate, you know, the flesh begins to get in and begins to work at you, and all of a sudden the enemy's talking on your shoulder. How are they better than you are? Right? Oh, they're just all into themselves. Look at how much they have to have, right? There's excuse at every corner to begin to kind of to brush away the significance of what God is doing in that church and how he's blessed them. And it's easy to begin to switch over what is glorious into the name of Jesus into something that becomes comparison and rivalry and anger and jealousy, right? And it happens in all of our relationships, that when we should be happy for someone, we're really on the inside. We might be liking it on Facebook, but if it had five thumbs downs, we'd probably do that instead. That we just can't handle it when we see somebody rising up and being blessed and prospering. Why? Because we want that to be us. This is what Paul's addressing right here. It's not just, oh, let's be nice to each other, and isn't that great? And then you get in the car and you start talking about all the ways that they don't deserve what they were just telling you they were getting at church. Oh, that brother, you know, that brother Susie, that sister Susie. I know what a stinker she really is. I don't know how she's getting all that she's getting right now. I just don't know what, you know, and all of a sudden in your heart becomes all this jealousy. You have to be careful not to buy into the lie of this world, which says that I have to get all that I can. And he says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's why Paul says, take this mindset that Christ had. Change your mind. Change the way that you think. So let's let the rubber hit the road for a second. So when you're in a situation, a conflict with a person, and you begin to react out of instinct in a way that you've always reacted, we need to pause for a moment, bring the cross of Christ up before us, and then begin to say, what would Jesus do in this situation? How would he love? And then we begin to remember all of our offenses towards the cross of Christ, and we begin to remind ourselves of all the blessings that we've never deserved that he has bestowed upon us one after another. Right? And then all of a sudden we begin to get a different insight on how to handle this issue or this relationship problem. And we begin to withdraw our greed and our self-worship, and we begin to plant seeds of peace and of joy and of love. And we find ourselves operating in life and peace. Jesus' mindset was that he laid down his rights, gave up his comforts, and forfeited his privileges so that others would benefit and prosper. That's what the cross was. Glory to God. So this is the mindset that we have to carry in life. Paul's not mincing words here. We can't excuse this away and go, nah, Paul, he's not being literal here. No, he is being literal here. To lay down your rights, to lay down your privileges, what you could get, the comforts of your soul, the necessities of what you need so that others will benefit and prosper and grow. Think about living like that all the time for just a minute. It's earth-shattering. Another thing is, in this mindset of Christ, Jesus loved with his eye on the eternal reward and not on the temporal reward. It says, therefore God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names. He was living for the glory of another world and not this, which is when you live for the glory of this world that comes out of that self-idolatrous spirit. But Paul continuously points us to the reward that is to come, not the reward that's in this life. And when you begin to think of life that way, you are able to love more freely, because then the things of this world really don't mean that much to you anymore. They all become, as the hymn says, strangely dim. I don't even really see them anymore. You look at the eternal reward that you can stand before Christ and receive the crown of life. Last thing, Jesus loved to the glory of the Father. We are called to glorify the Father, not just in our character, not just in our actions, not just in our words, but in our relationships and treatment of others. That in our relationships, in our marriages, in our working relationships, the Father should be glorified through our actions in those relationships. Something we should always ask ourselves, is this reaction to this situation going to bring glory to the Father, or is it just going to heap a bunch of coals on an already simmering fire? You put yourself in a small SUV for 2 weeks with three of the same people, And you will begin to understand what it is to not do something so that you don't start a fire. That you begin to learn that something that is usually a big deal, you should make it not a big deal so that you don't kill each other on the ride to California, right? These things become magnified on family vacations. And it's a good practice for us all to force ourselves to be with each other that way. Because when you come out on the other side of it, you're closer, you're more in unity, you're walking more in the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. That in all of our relationships, we are called to bring glory to the Father. Five things that we are called to do in the life of this love that I want to bring to your attention, and is spelled out for us right here in this scripture, is first, that we are not called to be driven by selfish ambition. Paul says, don't be driven by selfish ambition. What is selfish ambition? That is wanting for yourself more than you want for others. It is within your heart having a place of greed that you're working an angle in your relationship. You're working an angle in your argument to get what it is that you want. Regardless of what it may be. It may be simple, it may be large, it may cost money, it may not cost anything, but it means everything to you. That in your plight and relationships with others, you are continuously trying to position yourself to where you'll come out on top. This is selfish ambition, and it creeps up on us in the smallest and trickiest of ways. Well, I'm not selfish. Jockeying for position, trying to move others out so that you can get. Come on now. Selfish ambition is a small seed that opens up into a field of self-worship. We have to be careful that we do all things for the benefit of others. Number two, don't give in to conceit. Selfish ambition first, conceit second. Conceit is arrogance, pride, thinking of yourself more than you should. Elevating yourself to a place above others. Right? Self-worship. This is conceit. This is the very, dare I say, the very sin that Adam and Eve fell to in the garden. God just doesn't want you to eat of that tree because then you'll be like he is. Right? All of a sudden, their position became elevated. Out of the conceit of their heart, the darkness of their heart. They longed to be more than they were. They wanted to be lifted up rather than lifting him up. All things for the glory of the Father. Amen. Number three, be humble. That we must live in a way of humility. Number four, esteem others more than you esteem yourself. This is all coming from the scriptures right here. Now, esteem, what does that word mean? Well, I looked it up in the dictionary, and it means to respect and admire, but then the synonyms go on further to help us understand a little bit more of what this definition means. Esteem is to respect, admire, value, acclaim, appreciate, like, prize, treasure, revere, favor. All of these things for others more than yourself. Think about that for a moment. This is the level that Paul's calling us to. That we must respect others more than ourselves. We must admire others more than ourselves. We must value, acclaim, appreciate others more than ourselves. We must like, prize, and treasure more others than ourselves. Revere and favor others more than yourself. This is esteeming, holding people in higher regard than you hold yourself. Number five, look out for the interest of others as you look out for your own. That our hearts should always be that all men's needs will be met and taken care of, not just working for our needs to be met and to be taken care of. Now, does this mean that you can't worry about your needs or worry about those things. Not worry. Worry is a bad word. But be concerned about what you are doing in your life, where you're going, your interests, the things that you desire. Absolutely. That doesn't mean you can't do that. But you have to watch where you position those things on this side of eternity. See, all of this makes us bristle because really, again, the reason that Paul puts up the cross of Christ is because this is the crucified life. This is the life that says, not my will, but your will be done. This is the life that says, I die to myself daily so that Christ might be shown through me. This is the life that says, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. This is the life that says, I pick up my cross daily and I follow after him. This is the life that says, I crucify my flesh so that I might enjoy the fellowship of his spirit. To live and to love and to serve this way takes a crucifixion of our flesh on a daily basis. Philippians 2:1 says, is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Is there any comfort from his love? Is there any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Now, obviously, he's asking a rhetorical question because we can all say yes to those things in Christ. But we also find the strength to love the way he is calling us to love within this very verse. In other words, is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Receive your encouragement from Christ. Is there any encouragement in Christ? Of course there is. Okay, let's go one step further. Receive your encouragement from Christ and him alone. Because then other people don't determine the joy of your life. Only Christ does. And when you get into that place where only Christ brings encouragement to your heart. Well, let me just say this. It won't be only Christ that does, but he'll be the one that matters the most to you. He'll be the one that brings the most joy to your life when he's encouraging you. The joy of his word, the promise of his fellowship, the joy of prayer and just interceding with him and spending time with him, him encouraging through the voice of the Holy Spirit. When that becomes your foundation, then you are able to love and freely encourage others. So when you receive the encouragement from Christ, you can give the encouragement of Christ. Number two, any comfort from his love? Same thing. Receive comfort from Christ and you can give comfort to others. Allow his comfort to be your saving grace in your life, the final authority, the foundation of your life. Don't depend upon the comfort of others to make you feel good, because then when they're not treating you rightly or they're not comforting you or they're not there for you the way that they should be, you are able to still love according to the cross of Christ, which where he cried out, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do. Any fellowship together in the Spirit, if you want to walk in the way of the Spirit, you have to be fellowshipping in the Spirit. You have to have that continual relationship with the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is sent here to continuously lead us and guide us. We hear his voice. We can tap into the fellowship of that Spirit each and every day. He is waiting to fellowship with us, to be there for us. And when we make that our foundation, then we are able to fellowship freely together in the Spirit with others. Are your hearts tender and compassionate? We know this, that the heart of Christ is tender and compassionate towards us at all times. He is our high priest continuously. His grace is poured out for us each and every moment of our life. Amen. And as we walk with Christ, our hearts are made more tender, our hearts are made more compassionate, and we are able to reach out to one another in the shadow of the cross. Hallelujah. Walking in unity, walking in one mind, like-minded, loving one another and serving one another. The name of my sermon today was The Life of the Servant's Towel. Because everything I hear Paul talking about here is Jesus in John chapter 13, which says, before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. And it was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table. He took off his robe. He wrapped a towel around his waist and poured water into a basin. And then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that he had around him. And when Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus replied, "You don't understand now what I am doing, but someday you will." "No," Peter protested, "you will never ever wash my feet." And Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't belong to me." And then Simon Peter exclaimed, "Then wash my hands and my head as well, Lord, not just my feet." Simon Peter exclaimed, Jesus replied, "A person who has bathed all over does not need to wash except for the feet to be entirely clean. And you disciples are clean, but not all of you." For Jesus knew who would betray him. And that is what he meant when he said, "Not all of you are clean." Then after washing their feet, he put on his robe again and sat down and asked, "Do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you." That we live life with the servant's towel wrapped over our arm, continuously looking for opportunities to wash the feet of those who are on weary long journeys that are all around us. And yes, they may be acting like the devil himself, but through the grace of Christ, you can love. As the nails were pounded into his hands, in the same way he said, "Father, forgive them," you too can walk in a place of love and forgiveness and servanthood in all the relationships that he asks you to steward in your life. Because when it comes down to it, that's what we're doing. We are stewarding the relationships that he has blessed us with.